Welcome to the eFed Podcast, the brand new podcast exploring our crazy hobby that is fantasy wrestling. I'm your host, Mikey Unlikely, and I'd like to thank you for joining us here for our inaugural episode. A little bit about me, I've been eFedding since the year 2000. I've done it all in the hobby. I've been a handler, I've held championships, staff member, match writer, I've been the Fed head, and I don't think I'm better than you. I'm just simply a guy who likes what we do. I've got some podcast experience, and I want to talk about the hobby I love with more than just my close friends. So what is the eFed Podcast? That's the question on everybody's mind. Twitter is a flutter. First of all, we're going to be a short-form podcast. We're not going to be here for hours on end, folks. We're going to cover some news and notes of what's going on out there. We're going to cover some feds that are looking for new handlers, and maybe some handlers looking for some feds. We'll see how it goes. We're going to cover the question of the week segment, and each and every week we're going to get an interview with another handler or fed head in the hobby. I proposed on Twitter a few weeks ago that we start what we call the promo segment, where someone will call in and cut a promo or a role play in character. It's going to be a lot of fun. We're going to start that next week on episode 2, so tune in for that as well. Before we get into the show today, I want to thank our very first sponsor, DefianceWrestling.com, a great angle fed, a lot of fun, some very, very experienced handlers over there. Check them out, guys. DefianceWrestling.com. It's my home fed, and we're doing some good stuff over there, having a lot of fun writing some good angles. Check them out. Throw up an app, get accepted, and get going. DefianceWrestling.com. So, guys, first here on the show, we're going to cover a couple feds out there looking for new handlers. I asked everybody, throw up your feds, give me some info, and here's what we got back. Nike Pro Combat. Nike Pro Combat is an RP fed looking to grow its women's division as well as its world's title division. So any original characters are welcome. You can find them at Nike, N-I-K-E, procombat.jcink.net. That's Nike Pro Combat.jcink with a K dot net. We've also got Alpha Wrestling, alphawrestling.jcinc.net as well. Hybrid fed looking for a few more faces and female characters. Honestly, anything is welcome over at Alpha. We've been going a year and a half with weekly shows and monthly pay-per-views with on-time results. Come join the Alpha company in the wrestling world. Elysium Pro Wrestling. Check them out at elysiumprowrestling.home.blog. They need single heels and tag teams of any alignment. Applicants should grab the appropriate application on the WordPress site, fill it out, DM it to at ElysiumPro1 or at TitanusSam on Twitter. That's ElysiumProWrestling.home.blog. Also, Trinity Wrestling. TrinityWrestling.boards.net. It's an RP fed seeking singles and tag teams. Check out the Fed at Burrows 5. That's 5bwrestling.com. They're a bi-monthly, about to go monthly, angle fed, looking for new faces, tag teams, male wrestlers, female wrestlers. Out of character-wise, they're looking for chill people too. Don't we all love those? We got Championship Wrestling Federation. It's an RP fed with all kinds of wrestlers, but handlers who are reliable, interested, and willing to put in the work. You can apply there to make CWF the best there is at cwf.ewmania.com. That's cwf.ewmania.com/index.php. Also out there, guys, is Action Wrestling. It's a roleplay fed that's been around for a year and a half. Never a late show. Very encouraging and inclusive community. Booked by someone who runs an indie wrestling show in real life. A good range of divisions ranging from 700 words to 4,000. They're always looking for new talent to join the fray, whether it's faces or heels, singles wrestlers, tag teams, or micro writers. Check them out at actionwrestling.freeforums.net. I want to thank all the feds who gave me the opportunity to put them on the show today. Earlier this week, I posed on Twitter the question of the week. What is the one thing that is drastically different than when you started eFedding? At AS Dreamcatcher says, no more response promos or back and forth roleplays. They used to be the thing to do, but now it's frowned upon and against some feds' rules outright. I know that's the truth. When I first started role playing, it was back and forth constantly. You would write one, he would write one, then you would write one, then they would write one, and you're always, almost always in response. Now with things, that some things are on camera, off camera, that gets slightly confusing. At Claire BGTL answered, lesbian sex cults trying to be taken seriously, weren't a thing. That's a good answer there. At Project Holland 3 says, absolutely, it's Twitter. I come from an era before Twitter was even a thing, and we all communicated either through the boards or the chat rooms. The second thing would be the advent of angle feds. Pretty much no one was angle when I started. At Project Holland 3. At W is finest. When I started, I would lose due to favoritism. The other guy would never even RP, and I would still lose. Now it feels a lot more balanced. I feel good when I lose because I know my opponent earned it through their writing rather than them being friends with the boss. I think we've all been there too. We've all been in that situation. At HeathWilliams78, angled feds, definitely. Had no idea they were even a thing until I came back earlier this year. Angle feds were something I didn't find until the latter part of my writing career, I guess you'd call it as well. At Monopole 73805153, the art of trashing the opponent has drastically changed. In many ways, it is more refined as there is less homophobia and genderizing. However, you do lose the simplistic nature of just cutting a good promo underneath trying to tell a good story. I'm with you there. There's a lot. The style of writing has changed drastically. The old promo you would cut was very pointed and sharp, and nowadays everyone tries to be more suave and smooth. I definitely think that's the case. And we're all much more sensitive to things that would offend people on the outside. At Imagine My Venom says, when I started, it was either 100% real wrestlers or 100% original. You'd never mix the two. Now there's pretty much no real wrestlers anymore. It's all OCs. Also true. When I started doing this thing, I've played Kurt Angle, I've played Christian, I've played D'Lo Brown, I think I've played The Rock. It's, you would just grab a wrestler and try to live the gimmick. That's what got me into this in the first place. Pretty cool stuff. At Burrows5, Twitter. Back when I started, we didn't have this. It was go online and see what your character was doing, and that was it. It's crazy how much Twitter has changed everything. Twitter is a powerful tool, and it's the powerful tool that's promoting this show. So thank you everyone who answered our question of the week. At the end of the show, I'm going to hit you with next week's question, and you can hit me up at the eFed podcast on Twitter and answer that question for next week's show. Guys, up next, we have our inaugural interview on the eFed podcast. Dwayne, who is currently handling Pietro Geist in Defiance Wrestling, has decided to join us here today for a quick interview. I hope you guys enjoyed as much as I enjoyed talking to him. Hey, everybody, before we start the interview, I'm going to hit you with one more quick sponsor. It's time! No, not Vader time. It's time to turn back the clocks, folks. Brian and Mikey are taking a look back at the wrestling from their childhood from a new perspective, through adult eyes. The pair recap the wrestling and the angles of yesteryear, starting with the Royal Rumble 1997 in San Antonio's Alamo Dome. Check out AtomicDropcast.com. That's my other podcast with my good buddy Brian. We're basically watching wrestling from 1997 in chronological order, every Raw, every pay-per-view, every week, and recapping the action and checking it out, the wrestling we loved as kids, through adult eyes. AtomicDropcast.com. All right, guys, joining us today for the first interview ever on the eFed podcast, we have Dwayne, who handles Pietro Geist, currently in Defiance, formerly in your hearts.
Wow, first interview. Dang.
You're my first interview, Dwayne. You're going to be on the first inaugural episode of the eFed podcast. How does that make you feel?
Sweet. First time ever doing this.
Well, thanks for joining us. Thank you for the time.
No problem whatsoever.
Dwayne, how did you get into wrestling? I know you've been eFedding here with me in my home eFed of Defiance here now for, what, a couple months?
Mm-hmm.
And how did you first get into wrestling as a ute?
As a youth, grew up around it. Parents watch pro wrestling. Dad and mom, both huge fans. Just was always around. Cousins were into it. Come from a decent-sized family on my dad's side. Tons of cousins, all into pro wrestling. It was just ingrained in you. It was coming from New York. It was pro WWE, or at that time WWF, and hockey. And that was pretty much life.
And hockey, there and, you go.
Yeah, from day one, as far back as I can remember, I've been watching wrestling.
That's awesome. Growing up on it. I didn't have the same experience, but that's great. What era was that you were watching?
Born in 82, so I pretty much grew up in the 80s. I got the very beginning of when WWF started to really increase and Hulk Hogan started picking up.
Hulkamania.
Yeah, I that was my childhood. Being a little kid, everybody loved Hulk Hogan. I was a Hulk Hogan fan up until I discovered Sting and the Road Warriors, and I was like, wow, these guys are better. Forget Hulk Hogan.
The face paint.
Oh, yeah. Hey, look at my characters. Both of them have face paint. There's a reason.
There you go. The inspiration. So who are your favorite wrestlers growing up then? I mean, you said you were a little Hulkamaniac at first, and then Sting, the Road Warriors.
Yeah, and then it was Sting, the Road Warriors, and the Great Muta. And that, you see, face paint sticks around. it just was. It was the Road Warriors. I grew up watching Mad Max movies. My dad's kind of a movie junkie.
Yeah.
So I grew up watching those. I watched every single one of them. I own every single one of them. And it was like, wow, these Road Warrior guys are awesome. They're not the Rock and Roll Express. They're not this fluid tag team that's doing these tricky moves. It's not like watching the Motor City Machine Guns. These guys are just two ogres that are going out there beating the shit out of people.
Yeah.
And I was like, now this is something I can get into, because I'll be honest, the Flair Steamboat matches, they're great and all, and I love watching them for the drama, but sometimes you just want to see somebody just beat the hell out of somebody else.
I love a good brawl.
Yeah, and then it was like with Sting, he was cool. I had the same haircut. He wore the face paint. It was just, he was my hero, and still to this day, like, number one on the list. He was my hero as a kid, and even when he became the Crow later on, it was like, damn, he just went from awesome to even cooler. As I was a teenager, I was like, just can't knock this guy. He's just awesome.
So it's Crow Sting over Surfer Sting?
Oh, no, hell no. Sting all day, every day.
That's awesome. Old school. I love that. Well, growing up, so you went from WWF over to WCW, clearly.
Yep.
And at what point did you find e-fetting, and in what form? Because I know, as well as you know, it's been in many forms.
Sure. I was in high school, and I was probably just surfing some wrestling websites. It was like when the internet first came out. I shouldn't say first came out, because I remember using it when I was a real little kid, and it cost like $1 billion to be on Prodigy and do Mad Libs, and it was like $8 million. Tried to put my dad into debt. Then when I was high school and the internet started picking up and everything, just cruising websites trying to find spoilers, and then just kind of stumbled across it. I don't even remember the first fed I was in. I wasn't even sure what the hell was going on, because they were like role plays, and I was like, what the hell is that?
I just joined to be part of the group.
Yeah, it was like, at first my dad was like, is that like some Dungeons and Dragons type stuff? And I was like, I have no idea what I'm doing. I just show up here. I don't know.
Yeah.
And then from there, it just kind of grew, and I joined a Fed that was a smaller Fed, but next thing I know, they had gotten into PTC, which a lot of guys in our community know about and have some experience with, and then it just kind of branched out from there. I went from being like in this little tiny Fed in the middle of nowhere to all of a sudden, it's like e-fedding capital of the world.
Yeah.
It's kind of like Welcome to the Jungle by Guns N' Roses. You have Farm Boy, you get off the bus, and you're in the middle of Los Angeles, and it's like, holy shit, what the hell is going on?
Yeah, and you start getting pulled every direction. It's madness.
For sure.
Yeah. So what are some of the main feds that you were in, not only back then, but all the way up to today? Kind of give us a timeline. Break it down for us, and just, you know, obviously everybody's been in a billion feds, but hit the high points.
Sure. The Fed I was in, I think it was called like WWW. It was me and this guy Justin, who some handlers may know as Violence Jack. He was pretty big in the PTC community. The two of us were like the only ones out of that Fed to stay in PTC and get recruited by their places when the Fed, I don't know if they left or they closed down or some stupid BS. It was hard back then. There was politics with just about everything.
Yeah, just like today.
And we were in one of the tournaments, the global title tournament or whatever it was, and we both did really well and it caught attention. And while he got picked up by one of the PTC home feds that was run by the higher up there, Ron, I went to a little smaller fed called Global Wrestling, and then it just became Global, and it's run by a guy named James Pape. And good guy, but man, he would vanish for like months and just leave all of us handlers be like, so which one of you guys is a moderator or an admin so we can actually do stuff here? Because he would just vanish. And then come back to where his wife had cancer, or his baby got abducted by a transsexual Nazi Eskimo, or something out of the ordinary. And it was like, okay, dude, whatever. And then finally I just kind of moved on from there. I was in one of the higher fed, what they considered one of the higher elite feds there, called PCW. I was in there for like a week with a character that I had been using for a long time called Kale Law, who, if you're old, you may recognize him. I know like a couple of my friends do, even though we never handled together back then. And the gimmick was he was a vampire slayer. And my role plays were basically him hunting down supernatural monsters, or fighting Jason Voorhees, or Chase attacking the Predator, stupid stuff like that. I was in there for one show, debuted one of my buddies, and the place was just a mess. So it was like, you know what? I'm out of here. I'm not dealing with this. And I was kind of just floating around trying to find my place in the world. And I had a buddy of mine that I had met in PTC, and the two of us did posers and stuff like that. And he was like, yo, I'm in FWO. And I was like, what's FWO? And he goes, this is really huge fed. And I'm like, yeah. Really huge how? And I'm like everybody's trying to get in there. Okay, well, show me it. I said, sure, I can come up with a character to work with yours, because he was handling a Japanese character. He had his fetish for Japanese characters.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, I'm not gonna make a Japanese character, I'll make a half Japanese guy, half Chinese. He's like, okay, well, go for it. Made the character. It was called Jing Jing Zhang. I took the name from a stunt choreographer for a bunch of Jet Li movies.
There you go.
And because I love kung fu movies. And he was called X3 in the Dark. And I joined, and they somehow agreed to let me in. And I couldn't believe it. And that's how I met Ford and Seth and Ed and all them. And it was like kind of stepping into the big league. You feel like a rookie when you're showing up there, because you got all these guys and they're held in such high regard, and just frequenting different forums, it's like everybody talks about these guys like they are the pinnacle of what's going on in e-fetting.
Yeah.
And I couldn't believe I was there. Luckily I had some great helpers who backed me up 100%. One guy, Bort, I don't think he has anything to do with EW anymore. I think Ford's the only one that still knows he exists. And he backed me up. He was like a stepdad. He looked over me, he was a mentor, helped me out. He was one of those guys kind of helped develop my background, where it was, it's okay to be kind of a loner, it's okay to be kind of an outcast, because he was an amazing writer, had a bunch of great characters, but he didn't fit in with the rest of the group. He didn't like some of the popular people, and I find myself often hanging out kind of with some of those guys, because I don't care about popularity. The people who are good to me, I'm good to them. Some of the popular people treated me like crap, so I remember that, and I want nothing to do with them. And people are like, well, this person handles here. And I'm like, that's really great. I didn't like him when I was in this bed. Why am I going to like him now?
Yeah, why would I follow someone who thinks he's above everybody?
Exactly. Yeah. The X3 character wasn't very popular, I'll be honest. I loved writing him, and I tried to do as much crazy, innovative stuff that I could. But some people liked him, some people didn't, because he kind of rubbed people the wrong way. I got pushed. And because of, I guess, work rate and other stuff, and other handlers were willing to help me. Like, one of my first matches that I wrote in FWO was X3 beating High Flyer, who's now Jack Harmon in Defiance. And people then were flipping out. And it was like, why? What's wrong with getting somebody over who wants to work and wants to be there and is putting 110% in there? And like I said, Ford, he has always been extremely helpful to me.
Yeah,
super solid. There were some other guys that helped out a bunch. And then eventually, you know, FWO does that thing where it shuts down for a short period of time. And then Travis brings it back, and I rejoined after that. And I worked with a few different people, nothing major. I was kind of in and out of the hobby at that time. Then the next real big step I took was getting into ACW. I started off with a tag team called the Supernatural SWAT Team, or the SS. And one character I was just getting really interested in. His name started off as Arcady Rasputin. And I took the name from Omega Red. He's Arcady. It's his first name in Marvel Comics. And Rasputin, of course, is everybody's heard of Rasputin.
Old Rasputin, yeah.
At least I would hope so. I mean, I don't think I'm that much of a nerd. But... And it was just, this guy kind of grew on me. He went undefeated, and it was like, it just kind of organic. It wasn't me forcing wins. It was basically, hey, who wants to work with me? And it was, okay, you can have the win. I was like, okay.
So it's an angle situation.
Yeah, it just kind of popped up where I wasn't really asking to go undefeated at all. And it just kept building and building. And finally, it was like this Goldberg-esque streak to where people were talking about it. Hmm. And ACW short... closed his doors for a short period of time, came back. I rejoined because I had a lot of friends there.
Absolutely.
And the character kind of bloomed. I was like, you know what? I have an idea for this. And I had it where he was working with I did this thing where I just kept poking at Seymour Almasy, who was Orphan at that time, handled by Sean. Rest in peace to that guy there. I've known him for a long time.
That always sucks.
Yeah. And Keith Scott Zimmerman's handler. Crap, I can't forget his name. Can't remember his name, I should say. But the two of them, I kept having him poke fun. And finally, I got a little bit of a match, and I had him morph into this character called Gunnar Van Patten, or GVP, where you found out that the Arcady Rasputin, the Russian Wolf thing, was all just a cover because he had gone through this rough patch and just needed a fresh start. Well, he was his American Texan soldier that was going out there just kicking ass, taking names in the name of God for justice and all this other stuff. And
it's a big swerve.
It was a lot of fun. But as it does, ACW closed down for whatever reason. And part of me was kind of happy about that because the first go around I had there was full of a lot of headache and nonsense to where it was almost like a civil war in the Fed between this group of guys that I hung out with and these group of, and the more well-known people. I mean, it was almost like the radicals leaving WCW for WWE. Mm-hmm. It was bad. There was a group of like five or six of us that just were unhappy that we were carrying the workload while these other guys were getting title shots. And this one guy in particular was getting like every title in the world and handling like 85 characters. And it was like, dude, come on now. Yeah. You got to kind of help out everybody.
Share the load. Anyhow, yeah.
Anyhow, that went out, and then I went over to NBW, and I was going to bring in Gunnar Van Patten, but didn't really work out because I wouldn't just have him run over a character in his debut who had just been in the main event at the last pay-per-view, and even though he was an NPC, I wouldn't have GVP run him over, and I wrote the match, posted it like 2 weeks early, had everything set up for it, and I got great gripes about it, how it shouldn't have been so even. It was like, I'm not here to make anybody look bad. I'm here to tell a good story. And I think that's where I do my best work, is in the ring. Some people will debate me on that, but I think that's where I do my best work. I think my match writing skills are second to none. I do have to get used to the Defiant style a little bit, because you guys use announcers and present terms and stuff. I'm used to novel style with past tense.
Yeah,
but it's nothing too complicated to get used to. And it was like, you know what? I'm not going to use GVP now. You guys kind of turned me off to that. I talked to one of my buddies who I trust, and he told me, he said, you know what, dude? If you're not having fun writing it, don't write them. Come up with something else. And I ended up coming up – go ahead.
How often do you see someone come into a Fed, they run a guy over in their very first match, and it's the same old shtick every single time?
Exactly. And it's – bullcrap. I'm not here to do the Goldberg thing. Even though it happened once, I didn't ask for it, by the way, and I make sure everybody knows that. I'm not here for that. I'm here to tell a good story. Every character I write, mine or one of my friends, It's anybody that lets me work with their character. That shows a sign of trust and respect, and it's let me do it, and they trust me. And I make sure their characters look amazing. There are characters I've worked with where I've had the handler come back to me. I know one in particular, a gentleman named Marcus who handles an NBW. He's handled around the area for a bunch. And he told me outright, I wrote one of his characters better than he did. And that's because I take the time, I look at the character, and I see what's going to work for the situation we're in. Mm-hmm. And I pride myself on that. I think I'm okay at SAGs. I don't think I'm – Lord knows I can't do comedy worth a damn. But I tried. I've tried 100 times. It just doesn't work. I'm just not that type of writer. Okay. But when it comes to in-ring work, I know I can pull my weight. And I'd love to see – anybody step up and try to prove me wrong, because my stuff has gotten better as e-fetting as long as I've been doing this. It's gotten better and better. But anyhow.
Throwing the challenge down.
I ended up creating a character in NBW, Osore, and he's basically what they call in Japan, and I hope I'm pronouncing this right, because Lord knows I don't know how to speak Japanese. In Anryo, where it's basically kind of like the ghost from the movie The Ring or The Grudge, where they're vengeance demons. And I use a lot of visual stuff with him and the way he acts, the way he moves. But then in The Ring, he's this hard-hitting – he's like a cruiser – best way I could put it is it's almost like he's a cruiserweight Undertaker. It's like he just keeps taking a beating and getting back up, even against bigger guys. And – I was there for a little while, had a lot of fun with that character. I think I've written some of my best work ever with that character, be it seg work or in-ring.
Okay.
And then, you know what? I kind of lost interest. Not so much in the character, but I just wasn't happy in NBW. No brand wrestling, whatever you wish to call it. I use abbreviations. I know you told me not to. I just wasn't having fun. So I took a step back. Talked to some of my friends, and it was, okay, I'm going to take a break. Then I saw you guys in Defiance, and it was, you know what, I trust Ford, I trust Seth, they've both been extremely nice to me this whole time. Let me give this a whirl. I'm open to suggestions, and I'm open to ideas, and I have Geist, who I've been wanting to bring back from the dead, from after he was in Jolt for a little while, and it was like, you know what, I think I could have some fun here. And yeah. Ford immediately asked if I wanted to work with him, and I was like, yeah, I'm down. Bring it on. Bring it on. And that's where we are right now. Presto.
Awesome. Thanks. That's a great timeline, man. almost no stone unturned, but I'm sure there's plenty, yeah.
Yeah, I probably left out stuff where I certain people made me mad, and I hate certain people, but
we don't need to get into all that.
My first one. That's yeah, I'm trying to be nice. Especially when one person in particular is in our group chat.
Oh, I'm looking at you, Ron Hall.
No, it's not him. Even though he hasn't tried to sell me a lucha mask yet, I just want to see the quality.
He's definitely trying to sell you a lucha mask. He's just playing the slow burn.
Yeah.
Awesome. So, but no, before we get into Pietro Geist, who I've thoroughly enjoyed, by the way, in Defiance. Before we get into him, what are some of the characters you've played over your career? I know you touched on a couple, but just hit us with, you know, the names just so people might recognize, and we'll go from there.
Okay, basically Kale Law was the first one. That was my first big-time character. Then there was X3, Jing Jing Jiang, The Dark, whatever you wish to call him, from FWO and some other places here and there. Let me see. Then it was Arcady Rasputin / GVP and ACW and a couple other places. Then it's Pietro from Jolt and now Defiance. And then I was Fumo Osore in NBW.
Quite the array.
Characters from somewhere else. It's like only GVP is from America, and I didn't start off with him being American. I started off with him being Russian. It's like Kale Law, English. Jing Jing Zhang, he's American, but he's Japanese and Chinese. Then you got Arcady Rasputin was from Russia. Then his tag partner was from, like, Romania or something like that. And I just constantly – I don't want to do the boring American or Canadian thing. I mean, I do have a character who's Canadian, but he's also a deaf mute who uses sign language, so.
We've already got a boring Canadian in Roland, so we're good to go. moving on. Speaking of Jolt, you had mentioned them. Before we started recording, you were telling me that you're actually a poser artist. Where are some of the places you can see your poser work?
Jolt, if you can find them. I know Mac Brody's still there. Lorelei's still there. I think a couple other characters of mine are still there from work I've done. There's not too many people anymore that still have those posers up and about. Most of the feds that I did it for closed down a long time ago. I'm retired from that now because, God, posers just – I love working on my posers, but I'm never happy or completed with what I have. I'm always tinkering with them. I'm never just set with, hey, this is great. Always like, okay, no, I can do this with that. I can do this with this. And then I'll be honest, having to make posers for other people drives me crazy. It really does. Like, I'll make them for friends and out of the goodness of my heart because they're my friends and they deserve it for dealing with me. But other people, it's like, yeah, this character sucks. I totally have no artistic interest in this at all. No, I don't want to touch it. And then people find out you do it and they contact you every 5 seconds about getting one. It's like, you can pay me money. But on that same topic, I did make my micros for the Defiance.
Oh, those are your work website. Too?
Yep, I made Geist, Brody, and Lorelei.
There you go. Check those out, defiancewrestling.com. Hit the Defiance page, and there you'll see the micros.
Yeah, I do graphic work for a job, really. I do website along with some other stuff for a small company. So that stuff there was like, I think I could do that. I got in there, and I was like, wow, this is a lot easier than I thought. So just kind of pumped them out over like a day. It was like a boring Saturday.
It's cool seeing the actual masks or the face paint that you put on them with the flag gimmicks. I think the one looks kind of like a phoenix, but it's the German flag.
Yeah, it's an eagle, just basically with the German flag.
Gotcha. Yeah, it's really cool. Let's check those out, guys. Now, let's hit Pietro Geist. I've thoroughly enjoyed him in Defiance, like I mentioned earlier. Loving the character. He's a 6'7", 300-plus-pound German babyface. Wrestling history tells us the German is going to be a heel. And everything I've read, and I'm like, going into reading him, reading the character over the last couple months, I said, okay, he's German, he's going to be a heel. And I'm thinking heel when I'm reading him, but every time I end a segment, every time I end a match, he's a total babyface. I don't know how you do this.
That's the point. Originally, he was created as someone told me I couldn't do it. Sean, who was orphaned in Seymour Almasy, told me outright that there was no way I could get an Aryan over as a face. And I said, really? That sounds like a challenge.
Challenge accepted.
Never do it. And I went, I can do it. And the thing I do is, never once, and I made sure of it in Jolt. Everybody calls him a Nazi. Everybody makes those jokes because he does look like what an Aryan Superman would look like.
Yeah.
And it gets worse once Brody debuts because they look like the Nazi Super Soldier Project. And it was like, you know what? Just because he's German doesn't make him automatically a bad guy. I see it in WWE right now with NXT UK with Walter. Just because he's German and he's big and he's somewhat militant, that automatically makes you a bad guy. I mean, I kind of got the idea from Rammstein, the German band. Yeah. One of their songs, Links 2-3-4, was basically made because everybody kept calling them Nazis and stuff like that just because they're a German band. And they're actually like left-wing and they don't do a lot of that stuff. And it's like they're not racist at all. But because they're German and they sound a certain way, they automatically get that label attached to them. And sure, being an American, you automatically think World War – you think Germans, you think World War II and stuff like that. But they're not like that. And so I kind of put that out there. It's just weird that it automatically gets that assumption. And even you said it. You think that in your head, and it's going to get worse because I know how to write a German accent, and it's just how they talk. I mean, I've studied up a whole bunch on this to try to make sure I get it right. I do this with a lot of my characters where I get an idea in my head and it's basically, I'm going to study up on this as much as I can. And him and Lorelai, they're as German as can be.
That's what I was going to ask you next, actually, is how hard is it to have a character, two characters, whose primary language is one that's not your own?
It's a little difficult. Google helps every now and then when I can't figure out what I'm trying to say. But for the most part, the accent's not very complicated. You just have to learn that they put different emphasis on things than what we do with American English because of how German itself is. Like, W's turn into V's and S's turn into Z's. Stuff like that. Like, they roll their R's.
Mm-hmm.
The way they make sentences. It's not the same. And once you get an idea and a little grasp on that, it doesn't even have to be something major. You just get an idea of how that works, and writing it easy. Writing comes easy. I actually write it in English and then make the modifications to make it fit German after I'm done with it.
There you go. Yeah. That's awesome. I know I couldn't do that, so credit to you there. But no, Pietro Geist, he's been teaming up with Ford. He's been playing the sympathetic savior. And then going into the pay-per-view, you guys went up against the Stevens clan. Great match. Great match. Thank you. Yeah, great match. I don't know. I don't know if you wrote it alone or who all was involved. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Oh, I wrote it alone. And I'm not knocking Justin or Ford. I prefer to write the matches. I really enjoy match writing. That's why I'm in the hobby. The segs I'm forced to do. But
yeah.
Match writing is where I'm happiest. If I can do that all day, believe me.
I like when you intertwine the German language and the talking, and then you put in the commentary, you got them making almost Nazi jokes, but you're not putting the foot all the way down. It was hilarious.
I admit, the commentary, not very good. That was Brian helping out there.
I loved it.
Because I can do all that other stuff, but I have not yet accomplished how to write your guys' announcers yet and how exactly they work. Because almost seems like the one guy's a heel, but then he makes other comments. Like he wanted Harmon to kill the Stevens, which a heel commentator wouldn't make. So I was like, okay, I'm a little confused in this guy. And so I went to Brian for help, and he deserves all the acclaim for the commentary. I did the match writing and the storyline for that, but with the commentary, Brian deserves the credit.
Well, it was great that it was intertwined with what was being said by Pietro and his valet.
Mm-hmm.
And just intertwining all of that was good stuff. Great match. I'm loving what you've done so far, man. I'm looking forward to reading what you're doing in the future. You said you're bringing in another character here soon.
It can get a little rough at times. There's only so much you can do with these big ogre characters before it kind of gets stale. So yeah. I really sat down and tried to come up with some interesting dynamics of how they work outside the ring and in the ring between him and his soon-to-be debuting partner, and just how they interact, even how they interact with Lorelai and stuff like that, because Brody, as you'll see, is a completely different type of character than Geist is, and there's a reason behind that. They're kind of like the odd couple. No one would expect the two of them to hang out. You have this Geist, who you've explained what type of character he is, where he's just this German wrecking machine with a code of honor. And then you have Brody, who is Rob Gronkowski in my head. That's really who he is. And Seth put it to me that he just always wrote him as like a dude bro. And that's the first guy that popped into my head, was this amazing athlete who could do anything. And he's just a big dude bro that wants to party and have a good time and likes the girls and stuff like that. But he gets serious
totally
every
Gronkowski.
Now and then.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's exactly. And that's what I have in my head. So, but because they're two large guys, both of them are 6'6 and 300 pounds, they're not exactly going to be doing the Rock and Roll Express, Midnight Express, Motor City Machine Gun, Young Buck type stuff.
Sure.
But I can be a little bit more innovative with some power stuff. Like, I have some moves lined up. Some of them I've listed on the Defiance website, where it's just them basically having a catch with their opponent.
Right.
Because they're just so big that you get a smaller guy, say like someone Harmon size, guys could gorilla press him with one hand. I mean,
I checked out the roster page and I was going over some of those moves and I was gonna maybe announce them, but you know, they're all in German.
yeah, the names are in German just because I like making people use Google Translate.
Yes.
I
I didn't go that
don't see
far. I guess I should
if I
have.
have to translate it for you, that means you don't care enough to know what it is.
My journalistic integrity is at question
It's
now.
okay.
Awesome.
I've done the same thing a few times. When I had X3 and FWO, he had a bunch of moves that were in Japanese, and people were like, "I'm not even going to try to spell that." I'm like,
Yeah.
"Yeah, well, tough luck."
That's when you got to go to the copy and paste when you're writing matches.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And there's a good portion of that I use myself because I can't remember everybody's moves.
No doubt. Awesome, Dwayne. Thanks for joining us. That was a great interview. Appreciate you coming on. Learning more about Pietro, learning more about your history. Looking forward to what you're writing next, and really appreciate you coming on the show.
Not a problem. I apologize we couldn't get to more questions because I like to ramble, but not a problem. If you ever want to do a part two, I am available.
That would be awesome. Ladies and gentlemen, that was Dwayne. Wanted to thank him again for coming on and joining us for the eFed podcast interview. And I want to thank all of you out there for listening to episode one. Guys, check us out again next week here at the eFed podcast, where the wrestling is written, but the characters are real.